In this OSIsoft learning video, we'll see how to configure the PI UFL interface to import a simple text file, like this one, into the PI system. For a more complex text file, such as one with headers or different line formats, we have another video that'll show those steps with the PI UFL designer. This video is focused on the basics, a simple text file.
Let's start by opening PI Interface Configuration Utility, or PI ICU. Go to the UFL tab on the left side of PI ICU. The first thing we'll do is create an INI file. The INI file tells the interface where to get the data, what the data looks like, and then what to do with the data. To create this INI file, go to the ellipses on the right side of the configuration file box. Navigate to your PI UFL directory, then select the INI folder. You'll need to give your INI file a name. I'm going to call mine Example 1. Now that we've created our INI file, let's launch our UFL designer. The UFL designer will help us to configure our INI file. When prompted, select Yes to continue. We're now prompted to select a plugin. The UFL interface can read data from a few different sources: ASCII files, serial ports, and POP3 mail servers. There's a plugin to go with each of these data sources. For this example, we'll be reading data from ASCII files, so we'll select the ASCII files plugin. You can select the other plugins from the drop-down menu. We also need to define a data file as a reference while we configure our INI file. Click the ellipses and select a data file. Then click OK to start your configuration. You'll notice that UFL Designer is split into three different panes. The first pane on the left is the configuration pane. This is where the UFL Designer will walk us through the steps of configuring the INI file. The center pane is the data file that we selected as reference. We'll be using this as we step through the configuration. On the right side is a readout of the INI file that we're creating. The first step in configuring the INI file is to configure the parameters for the ASCII files plugin. The most important of these parameters is the input file mask. The input file mask defines where the interface should look for new data files, and which files in this directory are actually data files. For this example, I want the interface to read in any file with the .txt extension that's in the C data files directory. I can tell the interface this with a wildcard parameter. The wildcard character is star. So what I've just told the interface, a file of any name with a .txt extension in the C data files directory should be read into the interface. There are many other parameters that can be configured for the ASCII files plugin. I'm going to leave these at their default values for now. I'll also take you through the steps of configuring each of these parameters in the advanced configuration video. Now that we've finished the first step, we can click the blue arrow to move on to our next step in configuring our INI file. In this step, we define variables. We will need a variable for each type of information in our data file. So let's look at our data file. We have a tag name, a timestamp, and a value. We will need a variable for each of these three information types. Let's create our first variable by clicking the green plus sign. Our first variable will be for our tag name, so I'm going to call it tag name. We also need to choose a data type for each of our variables. In this case, our tag name is of data type string, so we'll select string. Now let's create a variable for our timestamp. We'll click the green plus sign to add a new variable, and we'll rename our variable to timestamp. We now need to select a data type for our timestamp, and a timestamp is going to be data type date-time. When we select the date-time data type, the date format parameter appears. The date format parameter tells the interface the format of the timestamp in our data file. Our timestamp is actually of the exact same date format as the default date format. However, if your timestamp is different, you can select from a variety of date formats from the drop-down menu. Now we need to create our last variable for value. We'll add a new variable, name it value, and then select a data type for our value. Our data type is going to be number, because our value is a number and it's a decimal, not an integer. Now that we've configured all the variables we need, we can move on to the next step by clicking the blue arrow. In this section, we'll tell the interface the different line formats that it might expect to see in our data files. We'll need a different message type for each new line format. Let's look at our data file. Each line in our data file has the exact same format: tag name, comma, timestamp, comma, value. Since each line has the exact same format, we'll only need one message type. I will go over how to create an INI file for data files with multiple message types in the advanced configuration video. For now, let's go ahead and create our single message type. We can do this by selecting the plus sign. I'm going to call our message type data. We'll also need to define a message filter. The message filter tells the interface how to identify a line of message type data. We can do this by finding something unique about our data line. However, since we only have one message type, we only need to tell the interface any line is a data line. In order to do this, we tell the interface C1. This represents the first character in each line, is equal to, then we use our wildcard character to say any character. In summary, what this message filter is saying is, look at the first character in each line. If it's any character, it's of message type data. The next parameter that we can configure is enable point creation. If enabled, the UFL interface will create points on the Pi server for any tag name that doesn't already exist. For now, I'm going to leave enable point creation at none. However, if you want to enable point creation, you can define the type of point that the interface will create for you. I will go over this more during the advanced configuration video. Now that we've created our message type, we can move on to the next step by clicking the blue arrow. In this section, we will tell the interface which parts of our data line belong to each variable. First, we'll select the message that we wish to assign data for. Since we only have one message type, It's already selected for us. Then, we click the green plus sign to add an item. We're now prompted to select the format of our line. How are the different variables separated? In our data file, the variables are delimited by commas, so we can select the delimited option. There are also options for fixed width columns and manually selecting. We've selected delimited and we'll click Next. Now we choose what the delimiter is. In our data file, our delimiter is comma. Once we select comma, the data preview window will show us how this separates our data. You'll want to review the data preview to make sure that's accurate. So let's check. We have our tag name, timestamp, and value, and these are all separated correctly. Now that we've confirmed, we can click Next. Here, we assign the variables to the different sections of the data line. We'll do this by dragging our variable. Select your variable and drag it to the appropriate section of your data line. The tag name we'll assign to the tag name. We'll assign the timestamp to our timestamp. And we'll assign our value to the value. Again, I did that simply by just clicking and dragging the variable. We're now finished assigning data, so we can click Finish. Now that all our data is assigned, we can click the blue arrow to proceed to the last step. In this section, we'll tell the interface what to do with each variable that we've just assigned data to. First, we'll select the message type that we wish to create an action for. Since we only have one message type in this example, it's already selected for us. We'll then click the green plus sign to add an action. We want to store our data in PI, so we'll select the Store in PI action. Then we can click and drag our different variables into the StoreInPI function down in the results section. We'll select our tag name and drag it on to the tag section of the StoreInPI function. We'll do the same with timestamp and value. Then we'll validate our result. Once we've got a green check mark, we're good to go. So let's select Add to add that action. Then we can close the Add Action pane. We've now told our interface where to get the data, what the data looks like, and what to do with the data. So we are done with our configuration file. Let's click the Save icon and close UFL Designer. Our INI file is now complete. There are a number of other parameters that can be configured for this interface. I will go over these in the advanced configuration video. We now need to tell the interface how often to look for data files. Switch to the General tab in PI ICU. We can tell the interface how often to look for new data files by creating a scan class. We'll create a scan class by clicking the New Scan Class button in the Scan Classes section. I'm creating a scan class with a scan frequency of 30 seconds. Let's click Save to save our changes. To start up our interface, in ICU, we'll select our interface from the drop-down menu, and then click the play arrow to start our interface service. We can check to see that the interface has processed our data file by navigating to our data file directory. Once the interface has processed a data file, it changes the extension of the file to _OK. We see that this data file has now been processed. For a guide on configuring the interface for more complex data files, please watch the Advanced Configuration video.